I feel a slight imposter, because I'm here to talk about Romans rather than Picts. You're allowed to boo at this point if you want. But there is a relevance, because in my view, the Romans are fundamental to what we call the Picts. The Romans, you can argue, create the Picts. The Picts and the Romans are absolutely intertwined. And so I want to talk a bit about this argument this afternoon, and in particular to look at some exciting new finds, and to look at the information that can cast on this question. This is not a new topic. People have been chasing the Romans in Fife in particular for a long time. This is Andrew Small in 1823, who wrote a fascinating and only slightly crazy account of Roman antiquities recently discovered in Fife. It's a topic I looked at myself some 20 years ago with a much less glamorous title, but hopefully rather less crazy contents, looking at some of the recent metalwork finds which have come up from the area and seeing what that could tell us about the impact of the Roman world on this area. Well, you'll see from the diagram on the right how much more evidence we now have to play with. In 1970, Professor Adam Robertson collated all the evidence of Roman finds, stray and site finds. There were barely six sites known in Fife. When I collated it in 96, 20 years ago, I realised there were 11 finds. That has more than doubled in the past 20 years. And so it's well worth revisiting this topic and seeing what it can tell us. For we have much more. We have much more evidence than we used to have. The 1996 map looked like this, a dominance really in northeast Fife. Today, a much broader spread, still a northeast Fife concentration, but with more evidence coming along the south coast. And you'll see the blue triangles are our excavated finds from sites. Most of these are stray finds. The finds coming off sites are coming off Iron Age sites. This is not really a story about men with swords and men with sandals. We are not really trying to trace the Roman army in this talk. There was a Roman presence in Fife. You can see it in the marching camps. I think your back face are dead in this one. Nothing is working. That part is not turned on, that's what you need. You can see the marching camps, probably early 3rd century AD in date. But the finds that we're looking at are mostly not telling us about the Romans present in this area. There are exceptions, a couple of really curious finds. A recent metal detecting find from Lower Hills, southeast of St Andrews, of a lead weight, a 4 ounce lead weight. And these tend to mark out either Roman sites or sites dealing with the Roman world. So I suppose looking for a missing Roman site in Fife, that's the place I would target. The other really curious find is this one here. From Peter Yeoman's excavations on the medieval monastery at the Isle of May, among the piles of medieval finds was a single piece of Roman tile. And this is a characteristic fitting here, which comes from the edge of a Roman roof tile. This is a weak basis to put a Roman building on the Isle of May, I must admit. And there's all kinds of reasons why something could be there. It may come from something like a temple, it's just as likely to come from much later ships' ballast, or even as a later souvenir of pilgrimage. So we can't really reconstruct our Roman presence and find the basis of this. But part of the reason I think there is very little evidence of the Romans in Fife is because they didn't need to be here. If you look at the middle of the 2nd century, then what we find is that the Roman military presence coils round Fife like a protective chain. And so you find a string of forts from the Antonine Wall heading up into Perthshire and across to the Thames. And it's been argued that this is, in one measure, effectively a shield for the well-behaved denizens of Fife against the nasty, hairy folk to the north of them. And suggesting essentially that people in Fife were friendly towards the Romans, or at least the leaders of people in Fife were pro-Roman rather than anti-Roman. And the argument is similar to what people suggest for East Lothian, where Tiprain Law sits as the dominant centre in this area, a client king, a friend of Rome over hundreds of years. Now, we don't have the same evidence in Fife because there's been pitifully little excavation of Iron Age sites in the area. We simply don't have the kind of excavated data we have from places like East Lothian. And this is a real shame. But we have hints. Some older excavations have produced scraps of Roman material. The really important hill fort of Clatter Craig near Newborough, smashed to pieces by quarrying, produced the odd piece of Roman material. This is a share of late Roman pottery. And from the excavations at Harrow Hill, there's been a proud foot excavations found a burial of Roman goods, including this snake-headed bracelet. The older finds in the 19th century, uncovered and then promptly lost, finds like this. This is actually an Angus version of vessels that we know were discovered in the Harrow Hill Cemetery in just west of St. Andrews. So there were people that were locals in contact with the Roman world. And contact with the Roman world was one of the ways he showed you were somebody special at this time. These weren't just means to the natives. You could use Roman objects as a way of showing off. Rome was an opportunity as well as a threat. And if you had access to Roman material, you showed you were somebody special, somebody different. So many of the finds, the stray finds that we have coming up from metal detecting, are likely to be dropped from local, not from Roman hands. Because Roman brooches were one of the ways you would show you were somebody special in Iron Age society. And these things, I've shown you some of the better rather than the more battered examples, but you imagine these things with colourful enamel inlaid down the bowl, with fine decoration on them, and these would have marked you out as somebody with contact. And sometimes you have to use rather more imagination. One of the most interesting Roman finds recently from Fife is this battered little example here. Now you can see from the enamel it's something interesting, but you have to know your Roman brooches to reconstruct it. Characteristically, it's from one of those things, what's called a dragonesque brooch, which mixes Roman and Iron Age, Roman and Celtic styles. It's one of these fusion pieces which comes as a hybrid on the edge of the empire, created as folk trying to come to terms with the reality of this changed world with Rome as your neighbour. And this is a topic we explored in the recent Celts exhibition, as Mike said. If you didn't see it, shame on you, it's too late now, it's all away. And these are really interesting. An example sits beyond the normal distribution map. This is a great example of the perils of distribution maps. A few years ago, I pulled together every dragonesque brooch I could find and plotted them on a map. And of course, the one we have is just off the map. But it's nice in showing how these things are spreading beyond their heartland. And they're common particularly in the frontier zone, born in Yorkshire, if you like, made in this whole frontier zone area here, but used beyond Hadrian's Wall. So these new fragments, these tiny little scraps from metal detecting, are really important, both in terms of the objects and the stories they tell, but the wider pictures that they can tell us about. And it's these wider pictures I'd like to turn to now. Because I've painted so far a fairly chronologically flat picture, the idea that Roman objects are important, and the idea that folk are using them to show off. But this varies through time. I want to take you on a bit of a time journey now, which will start in the 1st century AD and will, finally, end up in the Pictish period, so bear with me. Because the important thing is, time doesn't stand still, history is not standing. These things change, and the relationship with the Roman world and the peoples of Fife change. So before the Romans even get to Scotland, in the first half of the 1st century AD, there are bits and pieces of contact. Now, the Romans come north in the late 70s, early 80s AD. These are all finds that predate that period. And it's interesting, none of these finds come from the south of Scotland. They're all from the Forth Valley northwards. And to me, it suggests Roman attempts to build connections, to build links, to find out what they're going to be facing. And the fifth example is from actually an 18th century find of a burial found at Beresford near Ochtermuchty, where you, in destroying a cairn, clearing a cairn, you found a spearhead and this brooch here, which for us brooch aficionados makes you terribly excited, because it's a very early type, first, early So it shows these links to the Roman world before the Romans even get to it. And it suggests already creeping tendrils of political contact, some attempts to influence local people, of building connections to people far beyond the frontier. Most of our Roman finds date to the main occupation of Scotland and the times of sitting on the edge of the empire, the late 1st and 2nd century AD. There are over 250 find spots of Roman objects from Iron Maiden sites. So these things were really popular in Iron Maiden society. I'm not going to deave you with too much Roman history today. This is the potted highlights of the history of Roman Scotland. Three main invasions, late 1st century under the governor Agricola, well up into the north, fights the Battle of Longsgrabius, somewhere between here and here. Nobody quite knows where. Don't bother asking questions, I refuse to answer them, I tell them. Beats the Camassarangs, the Caledonians, but is then pulled back. And the history of Roman Scotland is really a trampoline history. The frontier moves back and forwards and back and forwards. Sometimes because of the ferocity of local resistance, but also because of wider imperial politics. Middle of the 2nd century, after this, the frontier is built on Hadrian's Wall. After Hadrian dies, his successor reoccupies the south of Scotland up to the Tay, builds the Antonine Wall. This too is short-lived, 15, 20 years, and then Scotland's abandoned again. And there's a final attempt to crush the rebellions or the uprisings of the Caledonians and the Maiatai, who are somewhere in the area where they are today, under the Emperor Severus in 210, 211. This too, successful. I don't want to dwell on the details of this. What I want to look at is this period between the Antonine and the Severus occupation. So we've seen how you have these early connections. And then most of the approaches I've shown you so far are falling into this late 1st, early 2nd century period here. The interesting time, and the time that's most critical for understanding, in my view, the origin of the Picts, is the late 2nd, early 3rd century. This is a map of something very particular. It's a map of Roman silver coin rolls coming off non-Roman sites. And what you'll see in contrast to the map I showed earlier is a strong concentration in southeastern Scotland, or central Scotland, up into Fife, Angus, Perthshire, and upwards the Murray Firth coast. There's a real targeting of this area. And we've been chasing these. Whenever a detective turns up coins, we are sniffing around in the fields trying to understand why they're there. And the finds I show here come from excavations of this site here in Burnley, near Elgin, where we were able to show these are coming off an Iron Maiden site, and that a series of coin hoards were sent north by the Romans a few years apart. This was a policy of payoff, of subsidy, of bribery, if you like. This is the Roman equivalent of used tenor stuffed into a brown envelope. And it's the realities of frontier politics. You cannot fight everybody. We know the frontier is restless at this time. One of the reasons that the Antonine Wall is abandoned is because the Roman frontier is restless. And so silver is one of the ways you deal with it. So silver or swords? Well, swords take a long time to organize. Silver is a practical political gesture. And I would see most, if not all, of these finds as being payments or gifts to powerful local leaders. And you'll notice in our spread here, concentration of these in Fife. There's been two or three recent examples which add to this story, one of them coming off an Iron Maiden settlement. Well, 10 years ago I tried to use this evidence to argue that in this material we could see the genesis. And the argument goes something like this, that you have a huge diplomatic effort in northeastern Scotland, north of the Forth, south of the Murray Firth. Material is being piled into this area to keep the peace. Coin boards, glassware, saveware, brooches, really flashy material. And if you then look 100 years later, this area is essentially blank. And I argue that this is because of the Roman silver. Silver creates the Picts. He is a vision, a 16th century vision of a Pict, as barbaric as they can get, if you like. And the idea is that the silver thrones are not just trying to pay people off, they're trying to create pensions. Giving people silver creates haves and have-nots. If I give you silver, and I don't give you silver, you start to be grumpy. Because he's got silver and you have. And so it creates this tension in society. And it does more than that. Because you create a dependency. People become used to silver, they want silver. And if you then cut the supply off, suddenly you make the big man anymore, or the head honcho anymore. If you don't have the silver, you can't use this to show off with, you don't look so impressive. So I've argued for a disastrous effect on local society of this silver. It makes people depend on it to show off with, and then it collapses. And out of this collapse, emerges an anti-royal faction, which is what we call the Picts. And at this time, we see lots of other changes. We see settlement sites being abandoned, art styles changing, all kinds of other things going on. Well, the story, I would argue, still holds, but we have some interesting new developments. And just last year, at a field near Dersey, this material turned up in a metal-detecting ram. This is a unique find of Roman silver. Not coins this time, but vessels. But not intact vessels, hacked and battered fragments. Found during metal detecting, you can see the photographs the finders took of the material starting to come up. And we were then able to go and investigate this fine spot immediately afterwards. And it was the kind of place we would never have thought to look. Here you see the setting, an unprepossessing cloud field, no archaeology known in the area at all. The burn runs not here, theirs is over here, there was something that's rise here. Nothing known at all. So it led us to a place where we had no reason to suspect anything. We did some geophysics, thanks to our colleague and supporter from Glasgow, which showed absolutely nothing. That's not entirely true. It showed drains, which you see here. We were excited by these were also drains. Then it showed a few black blobs. And these black blobs turned out to be interesting. No sign of a settlement. No sign of the normal material you see in a settlement. Well, the detectorists had been a little overexcited when they first found the silver, and they'd left an awful lot of it in the ground. So we went and worked with them to plot where the findings came from exactly. And we then used the JCB to carefully strip the soil away, layer after layer, working our way down through the subsoil. And we found this scatter of bits of silver, smashed up by the plough, by hundreds of years of ploughing. And the focus of the material, the original hoard, came from around about there. So why was it buried then? Well, when you clean the site up, you see something that looks like a battlefield. The lovely Fife weather was a bit against us here. What the rain does show is drains. These areas here are field drains, which we saw in the geophysics. With a bit of sunshine and a bit of effort, it began to look a bit better. And what we then see, this is the subsoil, the natural glacial subsoil. And cut into that are these dark features here. People have been here digging holes. And we then went and dug these holes ourselves. And in some of those holes, in two of those holes, were the broken remains of standing stones. Now we are still waiting to get the radiocarbon dates. That's the next phase of the analysis. But from pottery that was found in the adjacent hole, we suspect these date back to the Bronze Age. But we're dealing with a Bronze Age standing stone only a few yards from where the hole was buried. So here's the two sockets for the standing stones. The board is buried there, and down around there is a peat bog. This dark soil here is a small patch of poor drainage where peat formed. And for a prehistorian, peat makes your ears tingle, because peat is a place that people often saw in the past as sacred or significant. They would often put offerings into wet places. And the connection here between a much older ritual site and between a wet spot suggests to us that the material has been deliberately buried here, perhaps because it's a memorable site, we can go back to it. More likely, I suspect, because it's still a sacred site in the island. And in that, it resonates with some of the stuff that my colleague Alison was speaking around later on over the Nordic law. So we think his body is an offering. But what was in it? Well, you've got really battered fragments of four vessels. This one here, a rolled up cylinder, which we think comes from a fairly chunky vessel. We can't do much with it because it's been battered into a cylinder. We can do more with these fragments here. And these show us the character of the material really nicely. This is what we call haxel. This is not nice, neat, pristine vessels. These have been deliberately chopped and folded. This one here is actually a quarter of a dish. And you can see the nice angle, the nice right angle there. So a dish has been cut into a quarter and very carefully folded up. This is not just barbarians hacking silver to pieces. The work we've been doing on this and boards like this suggests that this is being used as bullion in the late Roman world. And I'll come back to that later, because it's really important. And the form, for typological geeks, the form of the moulding on the edge of the rim is exactly the same as the vessels like this from the Charousse treasure in France, which are of 3rd century date. This is really important because our coin hoards have stopped by then. And the silver here is a missing link. It extends this idea of silver gifts or Roman silver coming north beyond the period of the continent. So we've got a bit of a dish like this. We have these sadly battered fragments. The cloud has been really unkind to them. But look at the little scrolling patterns here with clusters of grapes, with tendrils, with a leaf pattern around the edge. And again, these fine French patterns in bowls such as this one in the Notre Dame board with vegetation pouring out. Again, 3rd century indeed. This would once have been a spectacular set of vessels. And the final one, again rather battered, but not just by the plough. The folding of these fragments here was done before it came north. It was done before it went into the ground. And the scalloping of these and the decoration are typical of what we call wash basins. And these were used for washing the hands and feet. So we're seeing here a glimpse into the world of the late Roman elite. But that's not how these vessels came north. They came north as bits of silver. They came north as fragments. And the parallel is to finds like this, to the Dupreuil law hoard. This great hoard of treasure found in 1919, the best example of hack silver which we have, over 20 kilograms of material. And a project we're doing at the moment, two projects we're doing at the moment, one looking at Dupreuil treasure, one taking us into the early medieval period, which Alice will speak about, is looking much more these things meant. And hacking of silver is common in the northwestern provinces at this time because the economy is in crisis. Silver is valued as bullion, not as works of art. It's chopped up and used to pay mercenaries, to hire soldiers, to give as gifts to these evil barbarians in the north. And that, we think, is the story behind much of this silver. It then goes on to be a fascinating afterlife, which Alice will touch on later. So, the Dercy Hoard raises questions about the politics of the late Roman frontier. And another recent find was exactly the same. And this is one of the great things with these little metal detecting finds, because they can take you places you never expected. This unprepossessing looking fragment from King Cable near St. Andrews. And here you see a nice drawing of it with Marion O'Neill, comes from one of these things. Now, I'm cheating slightly because it's a gold version or a gilt version of it. But these are crossbow brooches. Crossbow brooches are the symbols of the late Roman elite. Here we see Stilicho, the most powerful man in the Western Empire in the early 5th century, wearing exactly such a crossbow brooch, as does his son. These things marked out people serving for Rome. And they're incredibly rare in Scotland. This is the fourth. So they're marking out contacts to the late Roman world, official contacts to the late Roman world. So how do we use affined, I dare say, the final and incapable to shape our understanding of the emergence of the Picts. Well, my argument previously was this, that we have the nasty Hades up here, and you have a buffer zone created by gifts from the Roman world to create a cushion, Clyde kingdoms, between the Roman frontier and their enemies to the north. The two recent finds push that boundary northwards. And they suggest that people in Fife, or at least in Eastern Fife, are playing with a clever game, or a dangerous game at this time, of dealing with the Roman world, taking these gifts from the Roman world, some of them perhaps serving in the Roman army, and getting this material and coming into their hands. Local prestige goods tying into this time of uncertainty. So I would still see in this material the emergence of the Picts. Because I think it is the impact of having the Roman world on your doorstep that rattles up and changes societies in this period. We can't yet disentangle the details of what's happening here. We're getting rather more details of what's happening in this area, as Gordon, I think, we'll be talking about later. But to understand the emergence of the Southern Picts, we need to be looking and teasing apart the information from battle fragments like these. Exciting. National Network. Thank you very much.